pizza. It's cheap, it's delicious, and it's portable too. For these reasons and more, it's the food of college students, soldiers, and birthday parties. This doesn't stray far from pizza's roots. As far back as ancient Rome, there's evidence that a flatbread with toppings was used as rations for soldiers. In Virgil's Aeneid, he describes a suspiciously pizza-like food when he says that the soldiers devoured the cakes of flour that they used as plates. Today, just like all the way back then, pizza is a fast, cheap, and convenient food. I'm Daniel Seehausen, and this is The Answer Archive. While there may have been a flatbread similar to pizza in the ancient world, most experts would peg the true beginning of pizza's history in Naples in the 18th century.
There are two things to remember about pizza. One, it's cheap. Two, it's portable. The cheapness and the portability of pizza made it food for the poor.
That's Carol Helstosky, a professor at the University of Denver with a research focus on the history of food.
I don't think it's coincidental that pizza's origins are in Naples. Naples was predominantly a port city. There is, along the Bay of Naples, a lot of working class housing. These were not spacious apartments. Very few people had anything that resembled a working kitchen. And so people lived on street food. And the street food had to be cheap because people lived, you know, daily wages, or they were day laborers, or they worked on, you know, on unloading ships or fishing or whatever they could do to get by. So a lot of people had to live on street food, and the food had to be portable. Food had to be brought into these working class neighborhoods and sold to people.
In the early days of pizza, it would have been sold like hot dogs on the streets of New York City today. The pizza would have been brought into poor areas by the cooks and set up on tables in the hot sun, and then sold by the slice for very little money to the workers who needed a meal. And for at least 100 years, pizza remained a working class food. In 1831, Samuel Morse, of Morse code fame, gave pizza a rave review. A species of most nauseating cake. It altogether looks like a piece of bread that had been taken reeking out of the sewer. But that started to change in the 19th century, when Italy was unifying.
Italy was not so unified even after it was politically unified, right? And bringing together all these folks on this rocky peninsula was no easy task. Queen Margherita is visiting Naples, and this is a big deal for someone from central Italy to go down to the city of Naples. And while they are there, she would like to try some characteristic food. She doesn't say, I want to have food of the poor, I don't think. But in any case, as the myth goes, she wants to try this pizza. And so Raffaele Esposito, who's a famous pizza maker, creates these pizzas for her.
He made the queen three pizzas. The first was topped with lard, cacio cavello, a type of cheese, and basil. The second pizza had fish on it. And he also made her pizza al mozzarella, which was topped with basil, tomatoes, and, of course, mozzarella cheese. Pizza al mozzarella was Queen Margherita's favorite of the three.
And so she proclaims she likes this one the best. And then there is, in pizzeria, there is a card saying, you know, I have tried these pizzas, I proclaim them quite good. And so the pizza is then named after her. And it's this great story. It's also very patriotic because the white of the mozzarella, the red of the tomatoes, the green of the basil, these are the colors of the Italian flag, right?
And that is the origin story of the pizza margherita. But as Italy unified, there weren't enough jobs for poor rural Italians, especially in the south of Italy. And opportunities began to open up around the world from burgeoning empires like America. Demand for manual labor around the 20th century, especially in factories, on plantations, on railroads, and in mines, pushed Italians to look elsewhere for, as they put it, work and bread. Because of these factors, record numbers of Italians left Italy from 1876 to 1915. By some counts, as many as 11 million, which was nearly a third of the population of Italy at that time.
If we think about Italy as a country, it's really good at exporting its population. Immigrants left Italy looking for better lives, so Italians kind of spread themselves all across the globe. And in doing so, you know, brought their foodways and food with them.
And one of the places that Italians went was the United States. Lombardi's was the first officially licensed pizzeria in America. He and his employee, Totono, started selling pizzas baked in a coal oven. Antonio would go on to open his own famous pizzeria, Totono's, in the 1920s. Though the original location of Lombardi's closed in the 80s, it reopened a few streets over, a decade later. It even still uses the same coal oven it used nearly a century before. Many of Lombardi's employees, like Totono, would go on to open their own pizzerias. This began what some would call the Pizza Belt in the Northeast. Though Lombardi's loves to brag that they were the first pizza in the United States, their website is literally called www.firstpizza.com. In reality, many Italian Americans were selling pizza without licenses prior to Lombardi's.
When Italians moved to a place, a lot of the pizza making was taking place in bakeries, was, you know, people would make these pizzas and again, like they did in Naples, you know, bring them out into the streets and sell them to people who were going off to work. And so there were a lot of mobile vendors all across the United States, wherever there were Italian American migrants. But the pizzerias are the sort of stationary places where you prepare a pizza and have people either grab it there and take it away or eat it there. And so these pizzerias develop in the Northeast and become, I think because of their longevity, become really well known. And we could talk about the New Haven pizzerias like Sally's, for example, Lombardi's in New York, et cetera, et cetera. That these are sort of these places that have staying power. And so they become almost canonical, right, in pizza history, really important places.
At first, pizza spread across the East Coast as an Italian-American specialty. Then it became popular throughout the United States because some decidedly not Italian men revolutionized pizza yet again.
The fast food pizza, right? Pizza delivery gets its start from Domino's and from Pizza Hut. And those are two companies that were started, or two restaurant chains that were started by men who were not Italian. They had nothing to do with Italy. Both of them set up shop purposely close to universities and to military bases. And I found this fascinating, right? Because students and I guess soldiers who were stationed at military bases wanted something cheap, they wanted something portable, and they wanted something filling. Pizza fits all those categories.
To some pizza purists, fast food pizza, like Domino's and Pizza Hut, is an abomination of safe, samey pizza. But its impact cannot be understated on pizza as a whole. After Pizza Hut was founded in Wichita, Kansas by Dan and Frank Carney, it grew quickly and spread pizza around the globe to unexpected places like Asia and the Middle East using a technique known as glocalization, where they would move into places that may have been averse to typical pizzas and would offer local variants with ingredients people would recognize to get them to try pizza for the very first time. Unlike McDonald's that would come into areas and shut down their local competition, Pizza Hut and Domino's usually didn't kill local pizzerias. Pizza delivery even accidentally invented a new kind of prank, ordering tons of pizza to the door of an unsuspecting friend or enemy. The most amusing version of this joke, in my opinion, is when US Army officials ordered dozens of pizzas to the door of an anti-war activist. But he had college students living at home, so he said, "When a pizza's delivered, I just stick my hand into my wallet without asking questions." He didn't even realize that he was being harassed by government officials with pizza. And with pizza available at nearly every street corner, and now even delivered straight to your home, pizza had only one more market left to conquer: home cooking. Another innovation was on the horizon that would revolutionize pizza one last time: frozen pizzas. In the 50s, frozen pizza capitalized on two trends to gain popularity. At the time, ethnic foods were becoming popular, and pizza came to represent Italians to the rest of suburban America. And perhaps, just as important, convenient foods were gripping the nation. TV dinners, boxed meals, and all foods that were quick and easy to prepare were becoming a new, profitable market. Pizza delivery and frozen pizzas took the dish from a slice eaten on the street or in a pizzeria to something eaten in the privacy of one's own home.
And so you have this whole food industry that supports the popularization of pizza, so it becomes ubiquitous, it becomes everywhere. One could venture a guess that people just inevitably, right, the sort of the law of averages, will at some point consume pizza if it's everywhere and available in restaurants and available in grocery stores and on every street corner. Eventually, everyone, no matter how wealthy or poor, is going to get around to eating it.
These new options of delivery or just picking up a pie frozen at the store exploded pizza into every corner of the U.S. As Carol Helstosky put it, in 1945, few people understood what a pizza was. Within two decades, it was hard to avoid pizza. From Naples to New York, and from New York to the world, pizza has become a staple food for everyone, from the poor of southern Italy in the 1800s to nearly every college student in America today. Pizza is a part of almost everyone's daily diet, but few people think about the rich history of pizza. Whether it was made for the Queen of Italy at the turn of the 19th century or reheated in an oven to feed a family in the 50s, pizza will remain an important and iconic Italian dish for just about anyone at any time.